So Watch Me Work is a show, right? Where we talk about your work and your creative process. That part is very, very important. So you guys might know, might not, I'm a writer and I write a lot of different things. We have been doing this show live from the lobby of the Public Theater for 11 years. And now because of the whole coronavirus thing, we're doing it live. I'm doing it live from my apartment, and HowlRound, who has been helping us live stream for many, many years, is kind enough with the Public Theater. Big thanks to HowlRound and the Public Theater for helping make this live stream thing happen. We're going to be doing Watch Me Work 5 days a week, Monday through Friday at 5 p.m. So 5 days in a row every week at 5 p.m. because what else could we do except get together and talk with each other and give each other good, positive, supportive, loving energy. So that's why I'm here, and I hope that's why you all are here. This is how Watch Me Work works, okay? It's my timer. Wow. Now I'm at home. I have so many of these timers. It's kind of sad. Something happened. Something happened. Oh, well, whatever. So here's my timer. We're going to work together for 20 minutes, and you're going to work on whatever it is that you work on. You know what I'm saying? So it can be a writing project. Again, as you guys know, I'm most versed in talking about writing stuff. But it can be anything you need to work on to get your work done. The timer is going to go off. And after I'm seeing someone's calendar here. This is kind of weird. I'm doing a screen.
We're working on it.
Okay, great. I'm doing a screen share with somebody I don't even know. Okay. after we work together for 20 minutes, the timer goes off. And for the remainder of the time, which is going to be 40 minutes, we're going to be talking. Giving love to Elaine. I'm giving love to Elaine Avila. You know what? I'm looking at you and I'm like, I know you. And these people I've known for like 100 years, and now here they are. But after we work for 20 minutes, I'm going to be talking. You're going to be asking me questions about your writing process, and I'll be offering answers. Okay. We don't have time for people to actually read from something they've written. You know what I mean? It's not like offering a critique about a specific piece of writing. We're talking more about process. Questions like, I don't know how to start, or my characters aren't talking to me, or how do I know I'm done, or how do I keep going, or how do I set up a schedule, especially in these crazy times, or whatever. Okay. We'll be talking about your writing process, your work process. All right. Anything else? And so Audrey's going to help. Audrey, one of our awesome moderators, is going to help with the nuts and bolts. Take it away.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so, so much for joining us. This is so cool. As usual, you'll be able to ask questions during our question portion after we write work for 20 minutes. You'll be able to ask questions in four different ways. One is you'll be able to raise your hand. There should be a raise your hand button, in the bottom of your screen. Let me know in the chat if you can't see it, and I'll help you figure out where it is. And if you're watching the stream online, you can also tweet at us at the Public Theater Twitter or into our Instagram messages. And then the final way is that you can tweet at us at WatchMeWorkSLP with the hashtag HowlRound, which is HowlRound. And that is that. And when you raise your hand on the Zoom, if you're in the Zoom portion, I will unmute you when we're able to answer your question.
I'm laughing because my husband was just dancing off camera. Okay. Sorry, I'm leaning over to get my notebook. It's all very organized over here. How many of you are homeschooling? Okay. It's a real challenge. It's all a challenge. And then those of you who are not, it's still a challenge. So we're gonna get ready. Everybody got something to write with and on and all that. I'm gonna use a notebook today. Usually use a typewriter, but good. You got something to write on. There you go. Okay, ready? So we're gonna start. I'm gonna turn it up so we can all hear it. Okay, here we go, and go. Yay. All right. So funny. That was 20 minutes. It's good. It's good. So now we've done the writing part, or as I say when we do it live, that was because this is like a show. So now we've done the action together of the show or of the play. And now we're going to do the dialogue together, which means that you're going to ask me questions about your creative process. So Audrey and Miranda, you guys are ready with the, okay. Who's got a question?
All right, Kiki, we got you.
Yay. Okay, so my question is, how do you start your 10-minute plays?
Aha, my 10-minute plays. You mean, I don't know if they're 10 minutes. How do I start, like a short play, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, how do I start a short play? What do you like to write on, Kiki?
Mostly feminist work.
Great. I feel like that's great. I meant like pencil, pen.
Oh. Usually pencil journal.
Great. Okay, great. Pencil journal. Okay. So, and you have your topics that you love, feminist topics, sometimes, mostly. Cool.
Yeah.
Right. So you just like pick it up and put it down. Right. You can, what seems to be, you know, it sounds like there's something keeping, holding you back, slowing you down. What's the trouble?
Well, I guess once I start writing, it's just hard to explain. Like I have an action that I see in my head.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And when I'm writing, I'm either overwriting it to where it becomes something totally different and it doesn't make any sense anymore.
Right.
Or it becomes what I want, but it's too short. Or like, it's not that 10 minute. It's not, I don't know. It's just
it's really okay. It's hard. I mean, that's the cool thing about like writing. It's hard. It can be difficult, right? And that's okay. That doesn't mean you're doing it wrong. It just means that it actually is difficult. Like, have you ever run a marathon?
No. Yes.
Yes.
Cross country.
Me too. Cross country. Have you ever climbed Mount Everest?
Never.
Okay. Well, that's hard too, right? It doesn't mean like because it's your experience and difficulty that you're doing it incorrectly, right? Okay. So the first thing you do, she said you start writing and you find that your writing is not expressing the thing that you wanted to express, right? But you do get to an end point. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And then you find that, correct me if I'm wrong, you find that it's not long enough. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, when you write it down, it's great. Pat yourself on the back. You did it, right? Okay. That's writing. Now you can do your rewriting, which is bringing it, making it make sense and making it make better sense. Do you see what I mean? So oftentimes the first time we write something, it doesn't say the things that we want it to say. So we have to do some rewriting. You understand? Okay. And the thing about it not being long enough, don't worry about it. So you time it, you read it with actors, and it comes out to 9 minutes and 12 seconds. Darn, I didn't make it a 10-minute play. I don't think I've ever consciously written a 10-minute play. I don't think. Maybe I have. Maybe I'm just, but I write plays of varying lengths.
Yeah.
Sam Shepard, you know, the great writer, playwright, Sam Shepard, he has his essay on time, and he says, time doesn't matter. Don't worry about it. Okay. So if you have at the end of your writing period a short play and you rewrite it and make it kind of address the things and the themes that you're interested in, you've done a great job. If it's 7 minutes and 12 seconds, if someone holds that against you, have them come on here and we'll have a conversation. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Right?
That makes sense to everybody. I mean, a 10-minute play, usually when people say 10-minute play, they just mean not an hour long or a 30-minute, you know? They mean short, you know, like 20.
Like submitting though. So like when theaters want to do the
10-minute play festival and they think your play, they are going to reject your play because it's 7 minutes and 12 seconds?
Definitely shorter than that. It's weird because usually my, like when I do 10-minute plays, they're around 10 to 15 pages, I guess. And this time my play was 8 pages and it was 3 minutes long when we read it. And I was like,
so read it slower.
No.
Throw a long speech in there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Bring a soapbox. You know, if your play's too short, bring a soapbox into the middle of your play. You know, a soapbox, like a box. Or a pallet of toilet paper in our times. Bring a pallet of toilet paper, have a character stand on it and just start shooting some shit.
Okay.
Blah, 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 blah. Great. Okay. Okay. But the main thing is you keep writing, Kiki, okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else?
All right. Amara has her hand up. I'm going to unmute Amara.
Thank you. Hello.
Hi, Amara. Hi.
Hi, Suzan-Lori. So I'm working on something. It's called Manic Pixie Dream Girls Aren't Black. And I don't want it to be a musical, but I think it's a musical. Can you talk a little bit about the difference between plays with music and musicals, or what you think they are?
So you don't want to be, you don't want it to be a musical, Amara, but you, but it has music in it. Songs and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Well, I think the difference between a play with music in it and a musical is the I mean, all I know are examples from my own work, or there's some Shakespeare plays with music in them, right? Songs.
Yes.
Okay. There's some Brecht plays, you know, like Mother Courage. You know, are you familiar with, you know, some of his, the Three Penny Opera?
Yes.
You know? I wouldn't call those musicals, but I would call them plays with music. You know, where the characters sing, you know?
Yeah.
Do you know the difference between a play with, I'm asking you, do you know the difference between a play with music and a musical?
I have a theory.
Uh-huh. What is your theory?
My theory is that, like, musicals, the songs must serve the plot. Like, they must move the structure forward. But plays with music, it doesn't have to serve the plot in the same way. Like, what I'm writing into the thing now is a bunch of smaller performances, open mic sessions, that where the music doesn't necessarily move the plot forward, but it might tell us something about where the character is. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of why the lines are blurring about whether or not this is a musical or not, but that's my theory.
Mm-hmm. There's a whole bunch of conversation about what's a play and what's not a play, you know. I think we live in the age, hello everybody, where like gender is fluid and you're worried about this. Yeah, it's okay. You know what? Write your thing. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
If a producer loves it and they call it a musical, then it's a musical. Who the fuck cares, right? I don't care. If you think it's a play with music, I think I would agree with you because you're writing it. You know what I'm saying? But I wouldn't get too hung up on the label of it, especially if the label is keeping you from writing it.
It's not. It's just that I was commissioned to write a play, and I'm scared that if I come in with a musical, they'll be like, what the fuck did you just do with your time?
Well, musicals are plays. Plays are musicals.
It's the same thing. Yes, I understand.
Yeah, like people are humans or whatever that relationship is. But yeah, does that make sense? I don't think you're gonna get slapped on the wrist for writing a musical when you were commissioned to write a play.
Cool.
You will get in trouble if you wrote a laundry list or a grocery list.
Fair enough.
Right. I think you're gonna be happy. I think they're gonna be happy. You did your writing. It's fabulous. It sounds like it's a great show. They're gonna love it.
Thank you.
Okay. If they don't, again, tell them to come on here. We'll have more people. We'll have in the comments question, you know, all those people over there.
Fair enough.
She didn't write a play. She wrote a musical.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Who else we got?
Sina, I'm so sorry if I'm saying your name wrong, has a question. I'm going to unmute you. Oh, maybe not.
Maybe not. Try it again.
Oh, there we go.
Hi. Hi. Yeah, it's Sina, but thank you.
Sorry.
Hey, Sina.
Hi.
Where are you, Sina?
I'm in Virginia. I grew up in Virginia. I'm in my backyard in Virginia.
Oh, very nice. Here. Yeah, it is. It's awfully gorgeous.
Yeah, it is. It's. I'm lucky. I'm glad to be here. Get some fresh air. I guess this is a question more about maybe your process, but do you? So I guess maybe this is a little bit about me. I'm in grad school for acting at Columbia, and I'm working on this play right now, and when we were just writing, I kind of found this thing of like, maybe it's like the actor part of my brain can't really turn off, but like of maybe like meandering. And I was wondering, you yourself, do you go into a scene that you're about to write and do you know like let's say it's a two-person scene, what these two people want from each other? And then write, or do you figure that out while you're writing, or is this even something to think about when you're first just getting it on the page and just kind of like splurging it out there?
So say it to me. You're an actor studying acting at Columbia, but you're writing.
I'm just writing myself a nice part, but it's also just a story. Nice. That's like
nice.
Yeah, it's like a personal story that I've always wanted to write. I've always written stuff, and so
I would say at this point, I mean, you're working on it right now.
Yeah, and it's like a first draft, and I'm kind of like, I'm not even writing it linearly. I'm kind of just like, just thoughts that come into my head. I'm just like, oh, this is a scene, and just writing it. But I have like the structure of it in my head, like the beginning and the end, and kind of what happens throughout. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, there are different tactics for different times, you know? So right now, I would say, Sina, if you're enjoying, I mean, which tactic would be more enjoyable to you right now? Would it be, I know what the characters want from each other, and then you write the scene, or would it be kind of just enjoying the process of writing? Which would be more enjoyable for you right now?
Oh, it's kind of hard to say, I guess, without trying both, I think. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty like there's some catharsis I find with just like pen to paper, just writing and what you were talking about earlier, expressing the things that we want to be expressing and like exploring them. I think I'm doing that.
Great. Great.
Yeah.
You're trying out writing. You've always been writing stuff. Right now, it sounds like it might be helpful if it's an enjoyable process. So if you find that is very cathartic and you're enjoying it, stick with that. But if you find that, gosh, I might be having a hard time right now, you know, then ask yourself, what does character A want from character B? Or maybe more specifically, what does character A want more than anything? And what are they doing in this scene to get it?
Huh.
Okay. It might not be something they want specifically from character B.
Interesting. You know?
Okay. Yeah. And that might, so a lot of times when we, you just kind of narrow your field of focus a little bit, that kind of narrows the field of focus. So you're not just writing anything, you're getting a little more focused. And sometimes that helps. It actually moves the distractions out of the way. Okay. You're still in writing mode. You know, I tell people that students or myself too, that there are two kinds of there are two courages in writing. There's writing and there's rewriting, right? Mm-hmm. And in writing, it's anything goes, everything grows. Huh. Just doing your thing, right?
Yeah.
And in rewriting, it's you take the sword of discrimination. You all know what that sword is, right? It's like, it's not, it's just like, you know what is and you know what ain't. That discrimination. And you're cutting everything that does not fit.
Huh. Okay?
So that, and that's a second kind of courage. That's the courage of rewriting. They both take incredible amounts of courage. So, you know, you're going to be doing the writing. You're just letting it flow, but sometimes it's more helpful to narrow our focus. Like for you, Kiki, you ran cross country, right? Kiki ran cross country. So cross country, long distance runners, there's a path, right? There's a track. I mean, if you're a track runner, you run like the 2 mile race, you run those laps, right? You're not just running anywhere, right? You're running on a track, on a path. And so narrowing your focus, Sina, sometimes helps getting in that flow. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
So it could help. But if it doesn't feel good right now, you might just want to feel good and feel that catharsis you get. So just write anything. Put a couple characters in a scene and just go.
Right. You
know, the most important thing is that you are creating situations where you are welcoming your process and you're feeling welcomed by your process. So at the end of the day, you can say, yeah, I did a little bit of something and I feel okay. I feel better, you know?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Joanne has her hand up. And just as a reminder for everybody, in the participant tab, there's a little button you can click to raise your hand. It'll put a little blue hand on my screen. So I see you guys.
You're doing a great job. This is fantastic. Okay.
Thank you.
I can't believe it. Oh my God.
Okay. I know. I'm like in shock. And now I've lost Joanne after all that. Oh, here she is. There we go. Unmute. Go ahead, Joanne.
Here she is.
You can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
My question is that how do you, because I see you just write and you're writing, but how do you make your characters round, that they're not flat?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What do you mean? What's the difference to you, Joanne, between round and flat? What's the difference?
Meaning there's more depth to them. And how to create that and make that happen within the character. So it's not, they're more interesting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I find is sometimes I may get one character that I feel that is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then the others are not really to make the play more alive for me, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So how do you get a play? How do you start that?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's a great question. That's a great question. Sort of creating your characters. How do we create characters? One thing I do is I dig deep. Okay, that's one thing I I'm not just interested in the characters who one might say are like me. I'm interested in every single character in the play or the novel or whatever it is, the screenplay, whatever it is I'm writing. I'm deeply interested in what some people might call background characters, or what some people might call secondary characters or tertiary characters, the less important characters, right?
Right.
And that comes from, I mean, and I, like, I'm not the first writer. I mean, that comes from, like, you know, Shakespeare's playbook, you know. That mofo was deeply interested in all the characters.
Mm-hmm.
Deeply. You felt like Shakespeare was listening in. What do you have to say? You know, that's why all the characters are like, wow, they're all remarkable and interesting, right? It's not just the main person, woman or man, whatever. Okay. So for us, when we write, a lot of times the main character can be like, I'm just going to do it up to my screen. It's hard to do, but I'm just going to, you know, mm-hmm. right? They're like, and you can't really see around them, right?
Yeah.
Because they're just taking up all the view, okay? But you really have to start looking, who's that? Who are you? Get into a conversation with these characters. Get to know them, right? Get interested in them. I mean, like when you go out, well, we don't go out much anymore, but but when you do have to go out when you go out to the store, when on that one day you go out to the store to get your 2 weeks of groceries, or when the kind and very generous delivery person brings things to your doorstep, take a look at them. I mean, you don't want to be too weird because they might think you're crazy. You know what I'm saying? But think about them. Spend some time, Joanne, thinking about them, taking them in.
Okay.
Not necessarily into your home, but into your heart. Okay. What would it be like to walk around in, say you go to the grocery store and there's a woman who's the cashier, you know? What would it be like to walk around in her shoes? Think about it. You see what I mean? I am constantly taking people in, you know, right? I want to know. I mean, that's why, you know, I want to know how people are doing. I'm empathetic. And I think empathy, feeling for others, right, makes for good writing, I think. Even if you don't have to get all into their business, you know what I'm not, you know what I'm saying? But just consider the lives of others.
Okay. And the last question.
Go ahead.
Do you, because I always hear you have to know where you're starting and where you're ending to write a play.
Mm-hmm.
Is that law?
It's a suggestion.
Okay.
It has helped many.
Okay.
But I would say it is helpful. Like if I'm saying, you know, well, we can't travel anymore either if you're in New York. But look, I'm in New York, but I'm saying if I were to get in a car right now and say, I'm going driving, right? And I just drive and drive and drive and shit, I ain't got much anywhere. I'm just going around in circles. Okay, great, you know? But if I say, I'm going to drive to, you know, Virginia to visit Cena, you know? I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to have a, you know, it does give my project a kind of energetic motion. Do you see what I'm saying?
Okay.
So what I offer you, Joanne, is you don't have to know for sure where you're going.
Okay.
You have to throw some shit up at the wall and say, maybe I'm gonna go over here.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So you can say the end of your play might be, and they live happily ever after. That's the end. And they live in a yurt, happily ever after, the end. You know?
Okay.
But okay. By the time you get there, it might have changed.
Okay.
And that's okay.
But that was helpful.
I'm glad.
Thank you.
That's why I'm here.
No, really, thank you.
Thanks, Joanne.
Okay.
All right, we've got Brianda has a question.
Hey, Brianda, where are you at?
Hi, yes, and you pronounced my name right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I'm really interested because I love diving deep, and I'm really interested in your process, whether you have a process for determining whether research is a distraction or whether it's like fear in disguise. Whether it's no longer serving the process, like whether you have like a litmus test to decide whether you keep diving into research or whether you just go back to just writing and rewriting.
Right. That's a great question, Brianda. When you say, I mean, you know, one could say research is a distraction or a fear after a certain amount of time, right? One could say not wanting to research is a distraction or fear because what, you're afraid of finding out something that you didn't know before. So it can go either way, right? Mm-hmm. So I would suggest if it's a topic that you know less about, you know, and you feel like I got to research because, you know, right? Like when I started writing this thing about Aretha Franklin, I didn't know anything about Aretha Franklin, so I did some research. But there came a time when I said, okay, you feel a feeling, you feel kind of filled up, like, you're eating dinner and you go, I'm full. At that moment, stop, right? You want to stop and start writing.
Okay.
Because you can, and this is the truth about research, you can always go back and do a little bit more.
I know. That's where I think I get into, because I nerd out about things. It's like, oh, I find this out and then I find this out and I find this out. And I think it's all helpful. Like, oh, I have to know the whole story and dive in deep. And pretty soon I'm like researching the book that inspired the, you know, all the source material. and I don't know like when it's too far. So I like the idea of feeling full.
You've gone too far, Brianda. I'm telling you, you've gone too far. Stop. When you're researching the book when you do that, when you're doing that second level of researching, you've gone too far. Okay. Because your job, I mean, I'm not sure what you're writing, but our job is to weave together. Goodbye. Sorry, I let my child play on video games today, so his brain is rotting. But I'm talking to you guys. Our job is to fabricate, right? And to fabricate, we take a strand of what's factual and lay it against a strand of what's fictional, and we weave it together, right? Yeah. Okay, not even the History Channel is historically accurate, but we're not doing that, you know. We're weaving together the fictional and the historical, okay, in a beautiful fabric. So when I say dive deep, what you need to dive deep in is not the research necessarily, because that's your go-to, right? You like research, it makes you feel good. Okay, good, stop. Stop. Get off the internet, put those articles down. Maybe give yourself a time limit. Like, I'm only going to research for 3 weeks or something like that. And then I'm going to start to write.
And do you do a lot of research first? Sometimes I get ideas and then the research starts and I'm like, oh, maybe I should have just gone in and get the idea and start writing and wait till a problem comes up and then research.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, for this Aretha Franklin project, I had to do some kind of research because I didn't know nothing. I knew very little. You know what I'm saying? And I'm working for National Geographic Channel and they're fact-based. So I had to do something just so I could have a meeting about her. You know what I'm saying? Because I knew very little. I didn't know enough to have a conversation about her. So I did a lot of research. But I also didn't overdo the research. I did just enough to fabricate, if you will, I'm mixing metaphors, sorry, to fabricate a raft that I could put in the water and start to float on.
Yeah. Just enough.
And the other pieces came to me as I needed them.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Just enough to create that raft. Okay?
Yeah.
And so you have to be brave. You have to be brave in your writing and your rewriting. You have to be brave in your research and your fictionalizing or whatever it's called, you know? Just give yourself enough to go on. Just enough to create that first rock to get yourself across the stream.
Yeah.
You know? Then activate your creative mind. You've got to. Too much research you're going to lose the story that you are supposed to be creating.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. We have about 7 minutes left. So Atiya, you are up next. There you go.
Hi.
Hey, hi, Atiya.
So my question is, I'm writing a play that's based in Jamaica, and of course, characters who live locally on the island, they speak with an accent. So I'm just concerned about how to best represent the everyday vernacular, especially having characters that are of different generation, and depending on like when you were born, how old you are, you might say certain terms that a young boy who's in his 20s in Jamaica now, he wouldn't say those things. So I'm just concerned about how to best represent each character using the context of who they are and where they're at in life. And then also making it, I guess, digestible to whoever reads or watches it.
That's a really great question. Here's a side question I have. Do you know the story that you want to tell? Do you know the characters? Have you fleshed them out? Are all those?
I have about 70% of the characters fleshed out. I've been with them for a long time. The story that I want to tell, I have it all in my head up until the first act. now I'm slowly working through the construction of Act Two.
Right. I would say, and this is going to be a radical suggestion, I would say do whatever. Because what I hear behind that question is, I'm not sure about what I'm writing about, so maybe this dialect question might be getting in the way of it a little bit. I would say have the 20-year-old young man speak as a 20-year-old young man would. Spell it however you think is appropriate. You know what I mean? It's not ever, it's not a patois. It's not that. It's not a pidgin. It's not that. It's not a lesser than form of another English or another language. It is the English they speak. So write it anyway, phonetically or whatever that you feel like is appropriate. You've got different generations, like you said, you've got different classes, different mm-hmm. people in different classes speak differently. You've got different, you know, all kinds of differences. Write it any way you can, okay? I would say for right now, don't sweat it being digestible to whoever might read it. Your job is to write it down, get it done, right? And then if you've got the story flowing along, then you can maybe go, okay, maybe I can modify this dialect or this way of speaking so it can be better digestible. But if you're worrying about that right now, you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Write it any way you can. Okay.
Yeah, I guess my obstacle was getting through the spelling of it, because it's not necessarily something that has like a formal written form.
Yeah.
And I'm spelling how I hear it and how I'm used to hearing it as I was raised. So that's really where my hiccup was. Like, how do I even spell this out?
Yeah, so how spell it like you hear it.
Yeah.
Like Death of the Last Black Man in the Whole Entire World, AKA the Negro Book of the Dead. Those are dead people. I wrote a play with a whole bunch of dead people. I spelled it any fucking way I fucking felt like it. And what I know, I'm sorry, Kiki, I'm scandalized. Sorry. I mean, I thought this was an adult show. If there are any children, put them in their rooms and make them play video games. But, you know, I mean, just write it the way you got to write it. Don't let those hiccups stop you. Don't let nothing stop you. Just write it down. You got to get the story out, okay?
All righty. Thank you.
You're welcome. Great question.
We've got about 2 minutes left.
2 minutes. Okay, my answer will be really fast.
Okay, the next person we have is Crystal Adams.
Hi.
Crystal from New Jersey.
Yeah.
Hi, girl.
How are you?
Happy to see you.
Happy to see you too.
How are your kids?
They're good. They're in a different room, so they didn't hear any of that.
Okay. Okay, go ahead. Sorry, your question.
Just a quick question, just because just with everything that's been going on, like I find that there's a huge wall and that it's been very hard to hear any new voices, like a new story, something to be inspired by, something. So I feel like even writing now, it's dry. It's very dry. And I don't know what to do to kind of get into a new place of finding something that brings me passion to keep going, to keep writing, to keep a story. I feel like I don't have a story right now.
I hear you. And I think a lot of us are there. I think we have to give ourselves a little space to hear it. Cause we always have a story. You know what I mean? Even mm-hmm. my kids are in the other room and my dog just got up on the couch. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? That's a story. We always have a story. Just, I don't think we always have time or make the time to hear it. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we got to make the time. We got to promise each other. And this is why I'm doing this 5 days a week, to make the time to do it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Even Crystal, if it's just writing for 20 minutes a day with me and the rest of everybody for 5 days a week, you're going to make the time. I know you got kids. I know it's tricky and you're probably homeschooling and all that, you know, 5 days a week, 20 minutes a day. That's a start. Okay.
Okay.
Maybe we can find other times during our day where we can piggyback on that 5 minutes. I mean, 20 minutes. I'm sorry. So the 20 minutes you do with us at 5 p.m. 5 days a week, maybe you can also find yourself 20 minutes in the morning, right? Mm-hmm. Or 20 minutes before 5 o'clock, you know, and then you see what I mean? And
yeah. Just
free write in your notebook for starters, because the process, the practice of just allowing yourself the time to listen to your story is what we all need to be doing for ourselves and for each other right now.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Great to see you.
So great to see you too.
Elaine, Avila, great to see you. Are these people, are these people, Molly Murphy, these people I've known, Rob, some of you I've known from, like, you know, real life. It's wonderful. It's wonderful to see you guys. It's wonderful to see all you guys here. And we'll get, we're good. 5 days a week, we'll be here, you know? Ryan, is that Ryan in the dark? Yeah, hi. Hi, Ryan in the dark. But, you know, we'll be here 5 days a week. Just keep coming back. We're here. It's free, you know?
Just to note, there's a different link every day. So make sure you sign up for each day. So I'll send you the correct link.
Okay. Aww. I love you guys. Stay healthy. Stay healthy. Stay safe. Okay. We love you. See you tomorrow. Come back.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.